Feminism Part 2, The Death of Distinction. Hi, I'm Christiana, and I'm back with another installment in our series on feminism. Today, I want to talk about the death of the differences between the genders. And I think it's absolutely detrimental to society. It's detrimental to our culture. It completely destroys the relationships between men and women, whether it be friendships or relationships, marriage. It just destroys the way we relate to each other. It affects everything. Feminists make the grave mistake of thinking that equality is synonymous with sameness. Let me say that again. Feminists define equality as sameness. They wouldn't officially define it that way. That's how they view it. That's messed up. I'm sorry, but it is. I say men and women are equal, but different. Meaning of equal worth, of equal value, but different roles. When I say that to feminists, and I made the mistake of saying this, standing up and saying it in a current events class of mine, my senior year of high school, I got lambasted for the statement, and I was told that saying men and women are equal but different is the same as saying separate but equal, as was the catchphrase back in the days of segregation between blacks and whites. Equal but different makes total sense. If you look at everything around us, anything can be used as an example. I like to use the example of a camshaft and a crankshaft. Both absolutely necessary to make the thing run, but completely different. Different roles, they're doing different things. The camshaft doesn't whine because it can't be a crankshaft, and vice versa. No one looks down on one and says, well, that can't do the job of the other one, so it's inferior. No, they're both necessary. They both complement each other, but they're completely different. You could look at it in terms of reproduction, too. In order to make a baby, you need an egg and you need a sperm. And they're completely different, and their roles are different. They're not doing the same thing. Both necessary. Without the one, without the other, there's going to be no baby. I recently heard a feminist remark that she was admitting that men and women are different, and she said, and I guess we probably have different wiring too, mental wiring probably as well. Are you serious? We are completely different, mentally, physically, all of it. I'm reading a book right now called The Decline of Men by Guy Garcia, and he talks about how the differences between men and women are so pronounced that it almost renders them a different species, if you want to look at it that way. The goal of the feminist movement and of society in general these days is to make men and women interchangeable. Take away the differences. It doesn't matter who stays at home and raises the kids. It doesn't matter who is the breadwinner. It doesn't matter who fights the wars. It doesn't matter who nurtures the babies. It can be either one. That, my friends, is perversity. It flies in the face of the way we were created. It flies in the face of nature. And we're seeing the consequences of it. People should be able to see the consequences, but no. They attribute it to everything but the actual cause. And that is men and women, mostly women, shucking their God-given roles and saying, I'm going to be something else. In all of nature, there are checks and balances. In every relationship, whether it be a friendship or a marriage, there's always one who's more the leader and one who's more the follower. Have you ever noticed that? If you haven't, just try checking it out. Any two close friends, for example, same gender friends even, or a marriage, one person in the marriage is going to be more the leader, one's going to be more the follower. Now, it's in varying degrees. Sometimes it's very pronounced and obvious, sometimes very much more subtle. Nevertheless, there is a difference. You're never going to be completely, exactly at the same level of leadership or control. Leadership is male. I'm going to say that right now, and I've probably offended a whole bunch of people. Leadership is a masculine trait. I know, that's not being taught anymore. Nobody, you know, the public school system has successfully convinced women that leadership is not a gender quality. It's something that anyone can do. It's something that women should especially be doing. I'm not saying a woman can't lead, but leadership is inherently a masculine trait. And it has been proven that men are better at it, and I won't get into right now exactly why that is, because I don't really have time. So I always find it funny when I see a marriage where the wife will brag that they're friends, they're really good friends. She'll say, you know, we don't have the typical marriage, we're best buddies, we're not, you know, he's not this overbearing chauvinist pig, I'm not a, you know, a feminist brat, we get along great. Usually I look over and the guy's sitting there looking whipped. The woman's saying, we have an equal relationship. What she means is, I'm in charge. She doesn't realize it, but to her, her being in charge makes it equal. So, there are checks and balances in all of nature, and I wanted to read an excerpt for you from this book that I'm reading called, as I said before, The Decline of Men by Guy Garcia. He went and had lunch, an interview with the CEO of an owner, I think, of Time Warner, named Richard Parsons. He told me about an epiphany he had had during an African safari he had recently taken to celebrate his 50th birthday, and I quote from here on. We came upon this pride of lions, he recalled, two big males, about 9 female lions, and a few cubs. And every time we would roll up, the females were engaged in some sort of activity, looking after the cubs, cleaning them up, or they were hunting, preparing the food, or eating. The cubs were always playing, that's what they do, and the males were always sleeping. Always! You know, you want a picture of a lion sitting up there roaring, so I asked the guide, what's up with these guys? They're asleep all the time. And he said, you've got to understand, this is nature, and everybody's got a role, and they have theirs. And their role is, one, to procreate, and two, when the bad guys show up, they get up and go to war and protect the pride. And it was a very simple thing, don't ask me why, it just sort of hit me like a bolt. In nature, you don't think about it, you just do what nature dictates, everyone has a role. And that's their role. And if you risk weight things, yeah, the females are always busy and they seem to be working harder and doing stuff, but it's all very low-risk stuff. The guys don't do much, but when they do something, it's all high-risk stuff. If you weigh it all out at the end, it about balances out. It's the balance of nature. Here's the book, by the way. The Decline of Men. I just found that very, very profound. That illustrates things very well, because a lot of times I hear that used by feminists to say men and males, including animals, are chauvinist, you know, by nature, because the male is the stronger one, he's going to be the dominant one, and so he makes the women work, and he just sits and he sleeps. Look at history. Men, overwhelmingly, almost entirely, all the bloodshed has been on the part of men. Men are the ones who have sacrificed, historically, their lives, their fortunes, their sacred honor. Everything that has ever been risked that was worth something was usually by men. I'm not saying women haven't made strides in history. I'm saying that men were always the ones sacrificing because they believed in chivalry. In my opinion, I have observed that there are three different kinds of chivalry now. And by three different types, I mean three different motives behind men who are chivalrous or gentlemanly towards women. And the first, I would say, is duty. You know, you were taught as a young boy, open the door for the woman, or, you know, act like a gentleman. It's just, that's the way you're taught, so you do it. Whether you feel like it or not, that's just, you think that's what you're supposed to be, so you do it. Second reason, because they want something. Admiration, respect, appreciation, or, you know, to get a woman in bed with them. The reasons vary, but there are guys out there who will play the nice guy, even when they're not, in order to get women. And the third reason, which is the only reason, in my opinion, to be chivalrous, is when men want to. And women need to take note of this, because men who sacrifice for women on purpose, because they want to, do it as a reaction to women being women. It's when they see vulnerability that they step in and they protect you. to demand that a man sacrifice for you and protect you and be there for you, and you're not fulfilling your side of things, is the most stupid, unreasonable thing. When women act like women, men act like men. Not always, but in general. There's something about a woman who is not fighting her God-given femininity, and she's accepted it. She's cultivating her femininity. And I don't mean in a warped, twisted way, you know, the high-maintenance woman or the slut, you know, that's a twisted version of femininity. I mean real, pure womanliness as God intended it, that makes, it brings out the best in men. It always does. Now, it brings out the worst in a bad guy, and she's going to need somebody to protect her, but in a good guy, it brings out the best of him. His protective qualities and his manliness. I've lived extensively in the Middle East, and I lived for half a year in Egypt, and when I was in Egypt in particular, I took great note of this, because it's impossible not to notice. The differences between men and women are huge. Men and women are separated in churches on either side of the aisle. They don't sit next to each other on public transportation, on buses. They won't sit on the same, they won't even sit on the same bench if they can help it. There are not a whole lot of male-female friendships. You really don't see that. And I think that's not necessarily a good thing. I think it's a good thing to have guarded male-female friendships. I mean, it's good to cultivate those, but they don't go all crazy like Americans and cultivate these opposite gender best friendships that we see, which, by the way, are ridiculous, and they lead to heartbreak and, you know, one person's thinking a relationship, one person's thinking, I view you as a brother, and yeah. And it's true that in the Middle East, there is some chauvinism. Actually, there's a lot of chauvinism. I'm sure everyone is familiar with the Arab male stereotype. But I found it, I have to say, my time there, so refreshing. That's the number one thing that I came away with when I came home from there. Sometimes I just want to go back. Because there are those Arab men who view women as second-class citizens. Literally, you're not of as much worth as I am because you're born a female. And if you're a man, you would be more valuable. But there is also a lot of just recognition that we are different. And that, I can't even begin to put into words how beautiful that is, and how beautiful it was to experience. I remember one time, a group and I were walking home from church. Most of the traveling is done on foot, and so, whether you're traveling on foot or not, you always have at least one guy, if not more, in the group. Girls never, you know, rarely travel alone, and sometimes they do, but always in a group. Anyway, the guys split up into different groups to go with us. As usual on the streets of Egypt, the guys on the streets began heckling us and harassing us and, you know, yelling out propositions and such. Became very, very accustomed to it when I was there. But what touched me then, and for a long time afterward, and even now when I think about it, was that when that happened, the guys in our group, I mean, the guys in our group were on the verge of brawling in the street. They were so angry. And it wasn't out of a sense of chivalrous duty. It was because we were women, and we were being harassed, and they felt like protecting us. As simple as that. Despite all the supposed drawbacks and disadvantages of a patriarchal society, one thing I can say is that I never had to explain myself or apologize for being a woman and acting like a woman, because they understood it, and they didn't just understand it, they expected it. In America, there is this huge loss of respect between the sexes. No more an appreciation of each other. There's no more a need for each other. We're being told that we can both do the same job just as well as the other. Okay, why is there any point in being a man or a woman, after all? Thank you.